So today is April 22nd, 2021. My name is Enshi, and I'm an associate curator at the Houston Asian American Archive at Rice University. We're pleased to be documenting Thomas Tran's art history today. Thank you so much, Thomas, for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
So to start, as we are starting from the very beginning, where were you born?
I was born in Houston, Texas. I forget the hospital, but it was one of the downtown ones. And then I grew up there until high school, and then I left to Ohio for college. Yeah, so strong roots in Alief specifically, part of Houston.
Can you share with us some of the memories of your childhood and the household you grew up in?
Household, I'm the oldest of three, and I have a younger sister, younger brother. We're all pretty close in age. We all lived in the same house when we were young. It would be the grandparents and then their three sons, and we would all live in the same house, and then eventually the sons had their own families and they moved out. But it was like everyone under like one roof, one story house, and it was fun back then. It was really fun. I remember it being like an open door policy. Like, I feel like these days I have to call before I go over to like a friend's house, but back then, like, people would just come over whenever, you know, like family, friends, family. I like that a lot, but that was back then. I think something special about the place I grew up in Alief was there wasn't a lot of a majority minority feeling when it came to ethnicity. Like, I remember going to college and I was so confused about racism and like I just didn't, I never experienced it or I never recognized it when it was happening when I was younger. And there also, like, there weren't many white kids, you know, it was mostly children of immigrants that I went to school with. So I think that, like, in Alief, I think that makes it, the children growing up there makes it a very special reality that the majority of Americans, I think, don't share, which is, like, super cool. Yeah. Yeah, that's the childhood, I guess.
Can you tell us a little bit about your parents and where they came from?
They're from Vietnam. They came over in 75, of course. But my mom went to, her family went to Australia. So she has a big family. She's one of about around like 10 siblings or something, I forget. And then some of them are adopted too. But all of them are in Australia except for herself and her sister that are over here. And then the dad's side came over here right away. They lived in Chicago for a bit, but it was too cold, so they came down here. And my dad's pretty, he's pretty well known in the Vietnamese community in Houston, because when everyone was starting to come over or moving in, he was one of the people that was either not founded, well, maybe, but he was very involved in the first TV network. It was either TV or radio. He doesn't talk about it too much, but every time we go out somewhere, he almost always knows somebody. Like, if we go to a restaurant or like a movie theater or something, like, he'll run into like somebody that he knew. So he's a very, very like personable person. And I think he started the TV radio thing. I think it was TV, I forget. Because when he was in the refugee camps, he would be in charge, or he would be one of the workers at the radio station. So he kind of got his hands dirty there. And then my mom worked as she went to school, and she worked as like a social worker for a bit in Australia. and then I forget what happened, but now what they both do is flip houses in Houston. I think early on when I was young, they had a convenience store, but then they were getting robbed too much and too much at gunpoint stuff. So they were like, no, it's not worth it. So then they sold it, and then they started flipping houses like mid-2000s. And then now we still have a house in Alief, Houston, where everyone's at. So, yeah.
So where their convenience store was it also Alief?
No. It was downtown. Mm. It was close to that area. You know the bridges with the red balls? You know, like when you're driving down the highway? Yeah. Yeah. The one that they, I think they light up now with different colors. But their convenience store is close by there. And yeah, they're just getting too much gunpoint stuff. It was, yeah, not cool.
Wow, that's really disheartening to hear that they had to deal with all these crimes. Oh, wow. And can you share what's some of the cuisines you had? Like some of cuisines? Your food you had during childhood? Like, did your parents had the time to cook, or do you usually eat out?
Okay. I think we eat a lot of the usual Vietnamese stuff. Some stuff I remember from childhood are there's like the soy or like the sweet rice, and then my grandma would always have like a bag of sugar, and then we would dip it in the sugar and eat it as kids. And then we did the same with strawberries. That was really good too. let's see what else. The egg fetus, and then you break it at the top, and then you drink the water, and then yeah, you eat it. That was good. And then of course the usual like pho and like the spring rolls and egg rolls and all that stuff. They do this thing. I don't know what anything's called apparently. But New Year's, we would go to our grandma's sister's house or brother's house, I forget. But they would give us these like little like soybean things in cubes, and they're like sweet. I forget what they're called, but I crave those often. If I could ever find it again, I'd love that. I get nothing too out of the ordinary. I think just mostly Vietnamese stuff. And then even now, we still just eat a lot of Vietnamese stuff. I think a lot of my friends, they couldn't say the same. a lot of them they prefer American stuff for some reason. But yeah, Vietnamese stuff, it's still the preferred cuisine at home.
Wow, if you happen to have a recipe, like a family traditional recipe, we'd love to archive that too.
Okay, I'll ask my mom.
Yeah, and you mentioned your grandma. So does she and your granddad as well also moved here in 1975?
Yes.
And did they share part of the caretaking of you or any of your siblings?
That was a weird topic for us. That was a point of contention with my grandma. Okay, so my mom is from Australia, and then she came over here, but all her family and her parents are all over in Australia. So over here, when I refer to the grandparents, it's the paternal side. So the grandma here and my mom didn't always get along because grandma would take care of us, but she would say the responsibility lied in my mom to do that. even though when they were working at the convenience store, it was only my mom and my dad working. So like when one wasn't working, the other was working. So it was, and then they were also raising three kids at the same time. So it was really hard. So I'm not sure. Yeah. So that made it really hard on my mom. So it kind of created a lot of resentment there between her and my grandma. I'm not sure why. I think because it is an in-law, and then her son was also her oldest son. There was like some favoritism, and then she wanted like the best for her son or something. I don't know. But she was hard on my mom for sure, and that was stuff that my mom would come out with and speak about even when my grandma passed at her funeral. So it definitely like that was, it was a tense relationship for sure.
Well, thank you for sharing that.
No problem. I hope they don't mind.
And do you have any siblings?
Yes, I have a younger sister and younger brother.
Were you guys playing a lot of games together growing up? And if you can share those memories?
Yeah, I think, okay, so sister didn't play a lot of games, but she's very competitive. So if we ever played a game with her, she would want to win. So maybe that's why she didn't want to play a lot of games. But me and brother played a lot of games for sure. A lot of online games, especially throughout like middle school, high school, for sure, a lot. And then that's also how we bonded, like video games, anime, manga, cartoons. Yeah, that was a good way. I think a majority of the entertainment that we had was definitely video games. And then that got me and my brother close, for sure. And then sister is kind of just doing her own thing.
As the eldest son in the family, were you like assumed many of the responsibilities for your brothers and sisters?
I think there was more pressure on me to do that stuff for sure. Role model type stuff from the parents. But as we grew older, that became more of a hindrance than any, I don't know, benefit I got from it. And I definitely recognize that. So I'm not sure if I'm still working through stuff like that, but let's see. Maybe, who knows? yeah, but definitely the oldest son, most responsibility, for sure, from the parents. Yeah, for sure.
What were some of the family value that you guys were emphasized during your upbringing?
Education is number one. We were raised Catholic, so a lot of the Catholic morals too. Definitely be good to other people. It's important to be caring and kind. I say this stuff, but I'm also not 100 on it, because it's stuff we were taught, but it's not always stuff that the parents exemplified. let's see. I think the biggest one is definitely education is number one. I think most of the community and social values that we learned weren't always explicitly taught by our parents, but usually from outside sources like the church or from just going to school. So parents mainly reinforced your individual responsibility within the family, and then that also included you're young, you're a student, so your job is to work hard in school for the family. I think a lot of Asian people could probably relate to that. Yeah,
definitely. And that's very prevalent in Asian culture, I'm sure.
For sure.
Did your parents bring you up speaking English to you, or mostly Vietnamese?
Yeah, we were all fluent at Vietnamese at one point, and then we lost it when we transitioned into public school and learned English. I think now most of us, we all understand it whenever our parents talk to us in Vietnamese, but we can't hold down like a more rigorous conversation. Like if we talk like more like idea intellectually versus like conversation and like day to day, like we can hold those types of conversations down, but the others, like if we talk like about politics or something, like there's no way. Yeah, that's where it's at.
Great. Did your parents share with you any of their Vietnamese story, I mean their stories when they were in Vietnam before they moved here?
They don't share it unless we ask. They're not the types. Well, sometimes they would, but like the day to day, I guess fun stuff. The what is it called? I guess the stuff that like isn't so like life threatening, or like the jovial type of stories, like they don't usually don't share too much of that, but like the rigor of like the whole like immigration, they definitely shared to like reinforce like their lessons and stuff. But I think a lot of the stories I had to like pry out of them, usually like just for fun at a dinner table, you know, like what else is there to talk about? So I'm gonna pry into your history type of stuff. Or like for like a school project, I like have to pry into them and ask them about their past. But usually don't bring it up too much. Yeah.
Thank you. And you mentioned that Alief is a very diverse neighborhood, and you probably didn't encounter the idea or the recognition or the self-identification of Asian American until probably a little later. Can you share what was the trigger that encounter that caused you to realize that identity?
I don't know if I would say there was a trigger. I mean, I think in school it was definitely apparent that I was Vietnamese and I wasn't like my Black friend, you know? So it's not like I wasn't aware of that back then. I think the only trigger was that I realized that I didn't understand racism I didn't understand it, or was aware of the issue of it or the gravity until I went to college and met other friends or met people that this prejudice affected. So as far as my own identity as an Asian American, I don't think I never really struggled with that. I just accepted it as fact. Yeah.
That's great. And next I'm wondering, how did art initially became a passion in your life? You mentioned that you went to a gifted high school for art students. Can you share some, like how your journey lead you into that path?
Okay, if I wrote that, I don't remember, but if I wrote that, it's not true. I just went to like a normal I went to a high school, but it was when you had to apply to get into it. Was, if anything, it was a high school for nerds called Kerr High School. It wasn't exactly for arts, but it was definitely like for smart nerd kids. Yeah.
Sorry. I think I might have misunderstood because it's gifted and talented program, but it's not for the arts. Yeah, my bad.
I was in the gifted and talented program in Alief since like the second grade, until like then high school, and then the passion for arts thing. I think that's something I still struggle with. Okay, so now I'm 24 and I graduated college maybe like 21 or 22 and then graduated high school 17 or 18. But I didn't start pursuing art like this as a career, I guess, until I decided to take it seriously in high school. And I say that like with air quotes. And then I say that because what I'm learning now is that, or I guess what I've been kind of learning is like that decision in my life, even though it may have granted me a lot of opportunities and like my growth as an artist has was affected because of that, it also was the cause of a lot of problems that I deal with now. And what I mean by that is, let's see, like I'm learning like what art is to me and like how that and how my practice as an artist doesn't align very well in like a career or like goal oriented or business type of mindset. If anything, it's the opposite. So trying to mix those two things, like the upbringing and the parents want, you know, financial success and for you to, you know, climb the ranks or like make money or whatever. But like I took that attitude and then applied it to why I want to try hard in art and take it more seriously, which was a detriment in a lot of ways. I could tell you that it has affected a lot of my social relationships, and a lot of the struggle I deal with now in where I want to go in the future as a career. The whole financial thing, like it was such like a kind of a opposites thing that it couldn't click with me in my head. Like, how can I make art that's good, that I like and enjoy, but also make money out of it and build a career and all that? It just, for maybe it worked for some people, but for me, just it wasn't working. So like right now I told you I'm in the parking lot of a casino in Washington, which is like in the northwest corner of the US aside from Alaska, and I did it to kind of find this passion or this sense of like what I really want to do and stuff. I don't know, it's confusing. I guess I'm 24, I'm allowed to be confused and shit like this. but I guess the passion, it's a weird word. I don't really know how to use passion when it comes to art, to answer your question, it was definitely like it was like a mental switch in my head. Like, I'm gonna try and go to college for this. I'm gonna try and like work hard and like get accolades in art. Like there was a switch maybe like mid or late high school that happened. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that part of the journey. And I, as I understand, like as all artists are kind of going through many of the like social stage, and I'm sure you're not alone. And as you
I'm
said,
sure.
Yeah. So can you tell us a little bit about some of the mentors or some of the people who influenced you deeply in your journey in art?
My high school art teacher, her name's Lisa Canaro, and I'm still close with her now. I'm actually gonna go visit her in a couple weeks here. She definitely supported the whole me making art thing, and when like I wasn't I didn't have it in me to enter myself into competitions because I was like, oh, what's the point? I'm not that, I probably won't win anyways. Like I had that kind of mentality, but she was like, she was just putting me in those competitions anyways. She signed me up herself. And then that got me a lot of awards. And then that gave me confidence to pursue it further, the art thing. Other mentors, I guess in college. Unfortunately, I don't talk to them. I haven't talked to them in a long time. But teachers that taught me a lot were a guy named Mike Lawhead. He praised me a lot. He didn't teach me too much, but he did. He was very accepting and supported me, I guess. There was a guy named Kovach who he taught me a lot of technical stuff, and he also encouraged me to like stay in the art game when I wasn't feeling too great about it. There was a guy named Gavrilo Ganadovich. I just called him Mr. G. But we always had like a lot of long talks after class. if anything, he gave me a lot of like insight as to what it is like to be an artist after school. And for some reason I thought I was better than that, I guess. Like I wouldn't have to deal with it as much, but like I definitely am. I guess there's a lot of like small mentors. None that are like prominent like figures, but a lot of small mentors along the way that have, I guess, played their role in my life. Yeah.
So you studied illustration in BFA at the Columbus College of Art and Design. Can you share with us some of your journey in that? You also did mention like your parents weren't too keen. I wonder if there are stories behind that.
Yeah, they weren't too keen at first. And I could say they still aren't too keen now. But I think just after the first year, they saw how serious I was about it. Like I would come home and then I would do that and like study and practice all the time. And they saw that and then that kind of like chilled their worries or the anxieties a little bit. Yeah. So as far as, and then even now they see that the financial side isn't totally working out. Or I guess I struggle with it. So it works out sometimes pretty well. But I do struggle with it. And then they're always like, you can always go back to school. You're still young, and they're not wrong, but at the same time, I'm still trying to make I don't know if I'm still trying to make the art career work. That's also something I'm currently dealing with. But when they would say that stuff now, like it's usually not, I don't usually want to hear it. because it's not supporting me in what I'm trying to do. It's telling me to go at it in another way. I mean, it's coming from a loving place, but that's how it's, you know, it's the whole parents telling you what to do thing. Okay, and then in college, I was definitely a workaholic. I definitely got that from my upbringing for sure. So there would be class, and then I'd have a work study job for like 15 hours that I would use to pay my like rent and expenses. And every other time I would like, it was me either taking care of like the stuff I needed, like hygiene or like chores or like cooking and stuff. And then if not that, then I'd be in the labs working on some project. So I was definitely a workaholic. And definitely, it also affected my social life. I had good friends there that I cared a lot about, but I would always like snub invitations to go out to work instead, which is something I wish I didn't do, but I definitely realized like the workaholic part needed to come out during that time in my life. It was nice being a community full of artists, because I think it's definitely hard to find people that like want to make art their lifestyle in Houston, or not in Houston, just in general. So that was really nice, and I have a lot of good friends I still have now thanks to it. Like if a young person asked me about college, I'd say you definitely don't need it, but you should find the community part of it somewhere, because I think that stuff's really important. The techniques and all that, the mentality, even you can find it online. You can even YouTube it, you know. And there are classes online now too that are much cheaper than going to a traditional college. If anything, that the community experience is I think was definitely the best part. Because I mean, it's even the friends I made there, like I still visit and call and talk to now, and they're people that I can relate to on a level that I can't with friends back home, you know. So that was really important. Yeah,
that's great. Can you share with us some of the community that you're with
from college or from home or what?
From all over
place. From all over my communities, I guess.
Mm-hmm. I saw that you work on Alief Art House, one of their mural projects.
I wish I was more involved with them, but I think I did the mural for their house, and I haven't really attended any of their events. I mean, I'm not in town now, but I do, like, if anything, I just share their stuff on social media. But I guess that's something that I wish I did better, to be more involved with those guys. Communities though, I guess in Alief, I'm still friends with a good chunk of people I went to school with. I'm involved with a children's book group they're national, but they have chapters in each, in most cities. Then Houston has one. And then before COVID, we would meet up like every Friday at a cafe to just, you know, talk about the business or art, or just be a support group for each other. So that's been very, very good to me. And then the college friends group. Those are guys that, like, we don't have to talk for a while, but every time I hit them up, then we can talk like we never, like time hasn't passed. And as far as communities go, that's kind of it. I think currently I've been thinking about communities more and how important they are to me. I've been thinking, like, how can I do something that would cultivate, either create or give back to, or allows me to be a part of a larger community. So I've been thinking about that. Yeah.
And you also mentioned that your teacher from high school or from the Columbus School of Art and Design actually submitted your project into a number of grants, and you were able to get them. Can you share with some of, I don't know if I'm covering it thoroughly here, but there's one in 2018, which is the year you graduated from Columbus, the Houston Arts Alliance grant on the support for artists and creative individuals, which is that the one that you did the murals with? And yes. Is there anything else that, please do share with us.
So that one wasn't, no teacher was involved in that. That was one after I came out of school, I was looking for work. And then one way to get some income was to apply for these grants. And then this one was a very flexible one because they had they're like, okay, we can give you this much, but you have to propose a project to us. And then if we like it, we'll fund it. So basically I could just come up with whatever project I wanted to do and then give it to them. And then if they say, yeah, then cool. And if not, then, you know, there's no harm done. So it was one, I needed to make money, but two, this was a great opportunity to put murals in Alief, which I thought would be super cool. I got, basically they give you the okay, or they accept it and they let you know. That was at the end of 2018, and it was 15K. Then they give you it half at front in the front and then half in the back. So at the beginning, in January, February, they gave me the first half. And then after I finished everything, and then February of the next year, they gave me the second half. So, I mean, I don't live a very lofty lifestyle, if you can see from my background. So that money went a long way for sure. But it also gave me the opportunity and the experience of doing a mural in the place I grew up in, which was super cool. And I definitely have my own feelings about that project, but I'm very grateful to have done it.
Wow. And can you share with us some other projects that you were part of, the Fox Power Team?
Oh, that was, I was trying to sign up for a second credit card to make taxes easier, put business stuff on one side and then other stuff on and then personal stuff on the other one. And then that lady referred me to a CPA. So Fox Power Team is a CPA team. So I got in contact with them and then they did my taxes and all that stuff for me. They're great. Shout out to them. And they commissioned me to do a piece for their lobby. So that's what that one was about. And that was also happening at the beginning of COVID. So I was gonna work on it in their lobby, but because of COVID, I had to work on it in my little room at home. So I rearranged my bed. I was sleeping in the middle of the room, and then I had the boards on the three walls. And it was really messy, but it was a good time. Yeah.
That's great. And during your college years, did you kind of group close relationship or friendship with some of the other artists? Like, have their styles influenced your style, or how did your artist persona like kind of develop, I guess?
That's an interesting question. Let's see. Okay, so I guess I think this is a trend for most artists. But like at the beginning, I was more focused on the techniques. So that kind of made my art very decorative. Like I was proud of it if I could like do the anatomy right, or like the value structure was really good, and then I would want to share it then, and then I would call it finished. Then after I got like some more mastery with that, then I could manipulate the techniques a bit more to support like an idea or a message. And then that's when I pivoted from doing more, just more, I guess, more decorative stuff that looked good to stuff with more story. And then that's also when I got into like comics and character design. It was character design first, and then I was like, okay, this isn't enough. I want these characters to also move. So then I also got into comics. So that's how, I don't know if that's persona, but that's how my focus has moved within art. And then friends definitely affected that. Stylistically, I've kind of kept to the style that I enjoyed a lot as a high schooler. But my friends would get me into like comics. Like I was not introduced to American comics until college. And then one of my good friends, well, he was all about American comics, you know, so he would kind of like recommend me stuff and get me into it. And I think it was definitely because of him. His name is Ethan, that I got into comics. I think comics is a good medium because I can use the skills I developed as an illustrator, but then now also wrap it around a story. And then, like, I was always interested in like anime and movies and stuff. So comics is really like just one step away from that. Like you hear about all the time, like people develop comics into movies or shows and stuff. So friends that I had in college definitely influenced how I developed as an artist, for sure.
That's wonderful. And I really admire the techniques, like you could render in those storytelling, and it's really visually compelling, as well as the concepts behind them. And I'm just curious, how did you develop those techniques? Like, did your training at the Columbus School help? Or was it mostly self-taught?
Mix of both. The school was definitely more emphasized illustration. But then they also like encouraged me to dabble in other things like 3D modeling or animation. So I kind of was able to experiment during my time there. But a lot of things I also had to learn on my own, like a deeper understanding of color theory or like anatomy. What was the rest of the question?
I guess if you have self-taught your techniques, and how did you develop your style and techniques?
Oh, that's a hard question. let's see. There was a moment. In high school, there's a website called DeviantArt, where artists would post their art, and then people can come and view it and stuff. It was more like a gallery. It was more similar to a gallery than how like Instagram is. And I met, I didn't meet, but I found a guy named Sergey Starko. He's either Russian or Ukrainian, like at least like East European. But I really, for some reason, I connected with his work, and I still do now. There wasn't any explicit meaning like that, but it was, he created these like glimpses into these worlds where it was, where things like just didn't, like, not that it didn't make sense, like you could tell like there was life here, or like there was a story, like something was going on, but it was not anything that you've seen before. So there was like a wonder and awe associated with it that really like captivated me as like a 13-year-old kid. And I guess still now. So when I talk about my own style, I don't even like talking about my own style. It feels a little pretentious. But I would have to credit him for that. I think a lot of my taste also stems from that too. Like it's a lot of sketchy graphite work that I prefer now as well. It's not like, and then if you compare it to like the I guess like what's popular, or I guess what other people are doing, a lot of people are doing like digital or like highly rendered and color, and I don't know, color's not a new thing. But I don't know. I don't know if it's because of him or if I've always preferred it, but there's a lot of power in a black and white image that sometimes a color image can't produce. So, yeah, that's where the style is at, I guess.
Thank you. Yeah, I totally can see that. Sometimes the absence, it's more than the presence. And I'm actually also amazed by the kind of different styles you can encompass in the different stories that you were working on. For example, the Bayou Kings is like a very, like the lines are very kind of linear, whereas and the surface is very flat, whereas your other projects like the Bubba Stories, it's like so well rendered, and you can, it's almost three-dimensional with your techniques, and your color comics are also really different in styles. Like, how did you develop all these styles and in your career?
It makes me embarrassed when you talk about that stuff. I guess it's not super conscious developing style. It's more so like what I'm gravitating to or just wanting or am interested in at the time, and like I will experiment with that and try to incorporate that into whatever I'm doing. So it's hard to answer the style stuff because it's not really something I was conscious about when I was doing these things. It just kind of happened to be because I wanted to try and make this thing look good, and this is how I thought it would look good.
I guess it might be a painful question to answer again.
Do it.
Yeah, you kind of mentioned that it's been a kind of difficult journey to monetize your art. Can you share with us how it has been for you to kind of make a living as an artist?
Sure. I was definitely more keen on it coming right out of college, because I wanted to, you know, use my skills to, you know, make a career for myself. And in some ways I did. Like I did a good chunk of mural stuff. I had a lot of commissioned work. And it was working out. I wasn't making like boatloads of money, but it was working out. But it wasn't satisfying because I wasn't doing what I wanted to do. I was making projects for people, and it was paying me. It was helping me like live my life, I guess. But it wasn't fulfilling because I was doing other people's projects for them in a way, you know. I mean, some projects were nice and they like encouraged me to, you know, be me in it. And you can't expect that for all the projects. But that kind of led me, I mean, that experience kind of showed me that path of, you know, working freelance. And I knew that there was a ceiling to this, and it wasn't gonna take me to where I wanted to be. And I don't even know if I can articulate it too well now. But I knew that. So then I knew, like, okay, so what am I gonna do? Isn't art not the way to go? I've kind of pivoted over to a different passion, which is, I guess, traveling. And it also felt like, because art was so demanding, that I couldn't do a lot of other things. Like, I used to play video games all the time, but then I stopped because I got serious about art, you know. Same with like watching shows and these other interests. So right now, I'm less focused on just pumping out art and more focused on, I guess indulging in these other, not pleasures, but other things I want to do. Because after some time of doing this art stuff for so long, I kind of was not losing my identity, but my identity was just wrapped up in art. Like, I wasn't able to describe myself any further than like, I just make art, you know? And that was kind of like embarrassing, or not embarrassing, but like, it felt like a sign, you know? Like, artists are, I wish I didn't say that, but people that make art, like they're more than just artists, are more than just artists, you know. Like they're people too. And then I was kind of losing that part. Like, I wasn't letting myself do these other things that I liked, and then that kind of came out in my art, in the art being less life filled, you know. Like, it was, I guess, more generic is a way to say it. And I was feeling that. Maybe people couldn't see that, but I was feeling it myself. And I feel like that's, as the creator of something, that's probably more important than what other people think about it. as selfish or as stubborn as that might sound, like the feeling I have when I make something, I mean, dictates how I feel about it usually after as well. Like, I can't be excited about something if I'm not doing something exciting. And eventually it wasn't exciting anymore because, I don't know, there wasn't much to work off of. I wasn't really living life. There wasn't much, the ideas weren't really happening. I was just pumping out art. So now I feel like I veered off the question, but I guess right now I still have the desire to make art, and I kind of it was definitely a toss up because I was like, oh, if I stop doing it for a while, maybe I'll just lose the desire completely. And I'm glad that it's still there. Maybe it's too late now to totally give up art. It'll always be a part of like what I do, I guess, or want to do. But right now, like, I've been I've been traveling for over a month now. And the whole art thing is something I still think about. And monetizing it is something I still think about, but I've kind of been able to work through those thoughts. Like before they were just like constantly permeating like anything I did. Like when I would make something, I'd be like, okay, how can I share this or build a project around it or like monetize it, which is so gross. So now those thoughts don't come up instantly anymore, which I feel like is a step forward. So monetizing it, I think that was part of the original question. So monetizing was kind of draining the life away from it. And I don't think this applies to everybody. I don't think it applies to every situation, but because of my personality type to want to put my all into whatever I do, I'm more of like a do one thing and put my all into it versus do a lot of things and, you know, be okay at everything. It was a mix of that and also my upbringing of success. There's the whole success word again. I think you pulled that at the beginning of this talk, like how other people's journeys were kind of related to success. Yeah, but just like how I was taught to learn, or the definition I was given of success growing up. So I guess now I'm just like redefining that. And it definitely feels like counterculture or counter, like what my parents think or some of my friends think even. But I think that's a part of my growth right now, is to kind of separate these things and to not be too hard on myself, and not just make art to make art, but to make it mean something too, you know. Yeah. I think I answered the question, maybe.
thank you. And next, I'm wondering, how did you start this car lifestyle that you've been living this year? Like, what ideas start coming into your mind?
I wanted to do it for a while, and I finally did it like a month and a half ago. The idea came... I knew a girl in college. She was, I think, 2 years above me, and she was doing this thing already, this car life thing already, and then she's doing it internationally, and she's been going to like, I think she went to like Iceland first, and then she went to like Southeast Asia, and then now she's in like East Europe in like Ukraine or something. And then she got holed up there during COVID. But hearing her story definitely like inspired me and like showed me like, oh, this can be done. And like she's solo. So am I. And then she started in the US and she did it for like 6 or 7 months, I think, before she went to international. But I don't know if, I mean, I feel like everyone says they want to travel to some degree. But after hearing her story, that planted the seed for sure. Like, oh, I can do this. And then that seed was growing over like these past 2 years until the tree just couldn't be held in my head anymore. And I just had to do it, you know? So I did like some small trips to test things out. And then I finally made the decision to do it. Like I gave myself a date, and then like that day I'm gonna ride out and not look back. And yeah, it wasn't easy. It wasn't an easy decision to make. I definitely was thinking about it for like months, but I'm glad I did it.
So how has it been? Like I didn't know that like your bedroom is your car now. Like how
it
do
is.
You get your necessities in life.
You want a tour?
Yeah, please.
All right, let me see. I think I can turn the camera around. Okay. Okay. All right, so the table I was using is this cooler. Mind the feet. And then this is the pantry. And then this is kind of like where I just stash everything. And then this is like all the art supplies. I probably brought too many. And then this is the duffel with all my clothes. I moved that to the front seat at night. And then behind it is like a sleeping bag and comforter that I just pull out, roll out, and then I sleep in that with my feet stuck in the trunk. And then I can sit pretty straight. Yeah, so that was lucky. And then I have these privacy things that I made at home to just block out the windows. I have in the front too. And in the back, you can see that I'm in a parking lot of a casino. And in the front is, you know, the front stuff. Backpack full of art supplies. And then this is like, that's all snacks. And then I was just with my cousins. They have an RV. So I was just with them until like yesterday. And then we split. So I'm low on groceries. So that's probably what I'm going to do after this. But yeah, and now I leave the windows cracked a little bit for the air to flow out. But besides that, you know, yeah, I'm usually not in here much because it can be, it's not much room to work with. So like during the day, I'd probably just be out. Like if I wanted to draw or something, I'd like find a bench or something. But I usually don't spend a ton of time in here. Yeah. I'll turn it back around. That's the tour. The Camry lifestyle.
Well, thank you for the tour.
Of course.
Yeah, it's amazing life to be so like I guess minimalism in terms of how necessity can be. I'm also curious, like are you happy in this kind of lifestyle? Like do you feel like what are you missing in case there's anything?
I definitely still deal with, you know, being sad and lonely and afraid and all that stuff and anxious, especially anxious, you know, I still deal with all that stuff. Like I would if I was anywhere else or back at home in Houston. But there's more, I think if anything, there's more to look forward to out here because there's a lot to see. And that kind of helps me be hopeful, you know, and just like talking to random people also helps with that too. And then this lifestyle offers me that. At home, I wasn't a depressed fuck all the time, but I keep a journal, and then I would notice every day I would write like, so when's that car life happening? You know, like something like that, like constantly, and you know, just weighing me down. So if anything, I'm doing this so I can like get that off my list of things to do, you know, just cross something off. I'm going solo. I do miss like in one of my friends' posts, like they've been hanging out and stuff. I do miss that for sure. That makes me think of like, oh, I should go back and stuff. And like, oh man, why am I doing this? but at the end of the day, I definitely know why. And it's like to expand my perspective. And it's something I knew like in my gut that I wanted to do. So I at least need to write it out. Even if it's like, even if like things go bad, that's fine. Cause I tried, you know? So yeah, usually it's just me like, in my thoughts all day and I don't know if I can describe that as happy or sad. Most of the time anxious, but I'm usually anxious. Yeah, that's how the emotions are like here.
Wow. And I'm curious, how has your works kind of been influenced by your change in lifestyle? Has your feeling of anxious, anxiety, or loneliness sometimes fuel into your art?
Yes. it has before too, but this lifestyle, what it is physically, is like me in a car and like going out and trying to do things I've never done before. But then I guess spiritually and mentally, and how it's affected my creativity is, it signifies like a shift in values. Like I'm not just trying to make a living anymore. I'm trying to live a meaningful life, you know, or a life with meaning. Yeah, whatever. But how that's affected the art is, I'm a lot more, I've been experimenting a lot more than before. Maybe I was just sticking to stuff that was safe. So I've been more open to that, but I'm also more open to, let's see, I guess, exploring art in different ways, like, especially through writing, like exploring like my thoughts through writing. And not being so caught up in producing something that I can share with people, just making stuff for myself. So I've definitely taken a step back as far as not career, but yeah, probably career, like that path towards like making a career out of my art. Like I'm less married to the idea, for sure, because if it doesn't work out, if it doesn't align with the things that I want, the other things that I want, you know, I would love to make a career out of my art, but if it doesn't align with the rest of the things I want in life, then maybe that's not what I really want, you know. So, what was the question?
You answered it.
Oh, good.
And I'm also curious, how do you support yourself financially during this lifestyle?
Good question. So I had some money saved up from art stuff that I kind of keep as like, I guess, in savings. And then what I've mainly been doing for money is DoorDash. Apparently you can do it in every state. So like I would go to some city. Like I'm about to go to Portland for the weekend and just work DoorDash for the weekend. And it pays for like all my expenses and then even a little more depending on how much I work. But I don't even work that much. I work maybe like 15 hours a week. And then the rest of the time I'm like trying to find another mountain to climb, you know? So that's how it's been.
And where are you going next year in your journey?
I'm going to Oregon. The weekend is Portland, and then east of it is a mountain my high school art teacher was recommending to me called Tom, Dick, and Harry Mountain. So I'm going to go check that out. And then after that, I'm not sure what to do. This is usually how things go. Like I don't really know what I'm gonna do next, and I could research it, but I don't, because it's kind of fun like that. But I do want to hit there's a lot of really beautiful national parks in Utah, so I'm gonna make my way there, and then mid-May I'm gonna meet my high school art teacher in New Mexico because I'm house sitting for her when she goes on vacation. Yeah, that's what's next.
That it works out nicely as well. New Mexico.
Yeah, it is. It is. You can literally walk outside and walk up a mountain. It's super nice out there.
Yeah. And have you encountered any surprising, met any friends, new friends on your journey, or any anecdotes that you could share?
In a lot of these parks, people, especially I guess as a solo traveler, people are not always down to talk, but I've met a lot of people at these parks for sure, and a lot of them are friendly. I think in Big Bend, I met like I had dinner with these guys, and then one guy even gave me a ride back to the parking lot, and then we talked about like politics and stuff for like almost an hour. And then a guy even offered me a job in Yellowstone, which I think I'm gonna do. But the job, I called for it, and they were booked for the season already, or fully staffed. So but I still like the idea of working out there. I'm still thinking about it, if I should do it or not, but I think it's a yes. So I'm gonna try, probably after this, I'm gonna try and apply for stuff over there. But the guy that planted that seed in my head was like from Big Bend, which was like the first park I visited. And then all along these parks, you're meeting a lot of different people. Like there was like a traveling nurse I met in the Grand Canyon that was like camping down by the river. There was a guy that is trying to do a marathon in every state, and on his breaks he goes and hikes these crazy hikes. I'm not good with the whole anecdote memory thing, but there's stuff all over. And it's, I think that the general feeling I get from it is that people, I guess if you're open, then people tend to reciprocate. Like on these trails, I'm usually asking like people how they're doing. And a lot of the times that sparks a conversation. Growing up in a relative, like I guess Alief isn't exactly a city, but Houston is a very big city, and the mindset of like hustling and grinding it can kind of like leave a bad taste in people, especially between one another, when like you're like stepping over people to like get the work or the job or just to make ends meet. You can't like offer as much patience and time to somebody. So going on these trails and hikes, like it, I guess it's like a faith, restores like a faith in humanity type of thing. it's been a net positive.
And I'm also curious, like you brought up politics a while ago, and in your body of works and this fantastical kind of, unreal, but beautiful and innocent journey of these personas in your stories, have like your identity or any of the as we all experienced last year and this year, there's a lot of things going on that is very disheartening to many of us. So have kind of the pain and then the real world impacted your fantastical world in the art. And do you see Inca is doing that in, at any point in your life?
Doing what at any point in my life?
Sorry, yeah. They're like kind of allowing the kind of ugliness in the real world. Like we were hearing the shooting in Atlanta. Oh. And all the people, like not just Atlanta, but like I think a week ago we had another one that was yeah, that's just very heartbreaking stories like that happens to yeah, in the news and daily lives. And like, do you allow these sadness or politics or kind of, as I know that you had contributed to racial justice courses, like do you see that kind of the more activism or advocacy side being more engaged in your art?
That's a good question. I guess the closest thing I got to that was when I did, I was part of a team and we put together this zine and we got a bunch of artists and friends on board to promote it. And then all the profits went to support racial justice organizations and stuff. That was the closest I've been to it in that sense, I guess activist sense. But when I do hear this stuff, it is definitely impactful on me as a person. Like it's a constant reminder of like the fragility of human lives and how nasty we can be. I think it's important to relate yourself to these people and like see how this is like our current reality and how it can happen. Not reason with the bad guy, I guess, but to understand where they come from and how that can happen among even people you know. But how it affects my art is surprisingly it hasn't really affected it too much. I'm not like consciously like saying no, I don't want it to affect it, but if anything, these incidents are they motivate me to keep going the way I'm going, but harder, you know. I guess as an artist, it's important to be vulnerable and share your emotions and thoughts and stuff. And these awful incidents, like they kind of share like how important it is to do that for me, because I think one, it's kind of all I can do as an artist. Like I can't tell people to like don't do bad stuff, don't be racist. But I can share my own experiences and my vulnerabilities, and maybe someone can relate to that and not feel as isolated or alone. And I don't know how it will affect or how it will help these incidences that are happening, especially in America, but I'm sure across the globe, of racism and these shootings. But I think that's all I can do to help to basically live my most authentic life. And in some way that I believe will help the world. That's a very, I guess, bold thing to say, but I don't know. That's kind of what I believe. I think that's how I can help.
Yeah, totally. And I feel like the way that you have created that world in your comics and illustrations is definitely really healing and a world that we want to be in. So thank you for what you do. I'm also curious about you as an artist yourself. View the Asian American artist representation in Houston's art scene.
How do I view it?
Yeah, like, do you think Asian artists are being appropriately represented for its importance in the Houston art scene?
Beats me. You guys probably have a better idea of that than I do with all your documenting work. I have no idea. I have no idea at all. I wouldn't even say I'm very much involved in the art scene of Houston. I kind of keep to myself and to like my Alief community. Yeah, I don't know what's going on out there.
And I'm also curious what you do outside of making art. Like, what are some of your hobbies?
Hobbies. A hobby of mine is worrying about making art. I like anime, I like manga, I like to play games. I don't do any of those things as much as I used to, and I miss it. I like to hike a lot. I like to travel and see new things. I like to read. I guess you could say read manga's reading. That's kind of it. I'm open to trying things. I went snowboarding for the first time, a week and a half ago. That was fun. Trying new things is a hobby, maybe. Yeah. Nothing. Not too much. Not too much as far as that stuff. Hobbies go. Still a little boring.
What kind of manga do you read? I remember latest Attack on Titans has just concluded.
Do you keep up?
Not like all the time, but I started watching when I was in college.
I when I was back in Houston, I would watch it with family, but I don't follow it as much as they do. It is good though. Is it? You said it concluded already?
Yeah, and concluded about a week ago. Yeah.
Maybe I should go in and watch it then.
Have the manga or the video games. I guess manga will probably, yes. But how about the video games? Has it been kind of influential in your work?
I think so. I guess the most prominent video games in my life were Maple Story, back when I was like in elementary, intermediate, middle school age, and then high school. It was a lot of League of Legends, but that hasn't influenced my art much, or I haven't seen it influence it much, but I played with a lot of friends and that was fun. And then since then, I haven't played too much. The most recent one I played was called Hades, and the art in that thing is beautiful. The music's pretty nice too. It's a fun game. If you're into games, I'd recommend it. but yeah, that's the most recent one. Yeah, as far as games, that's kind of it. I want to play more. Like, I'm interested in playing a lot of story-driven games now, like Undertale, and then they made this like Asian one that's similar to it. And then also like the Mother series. And yeah, I feel like it's kind of lame to talk about these things I haven't played yet. But it's a lot of time to play these games, you know? Especially like on the road, it's hard even to find the electricity to do all that stuff.
That's great. well, it's definitely adds to the kind of variety in your life. And also, I'm curious, what are your kind of, if that's something that you think about that you plan to do in the future, like what do you see yourself doing in the next 5-10 years?
Oh, hard question. I don't even know what I'm gonna do this summer. let's see what, okay, so what do I want in 5 years? I've come to learn that a lot of pain and sadness come from having expectations. So I try not to have expectations, but things that I know that I'm heading in the direction of are like being more involved with the community. It's hard on the road for sure. It's a give and take, I guess. be more involved in a community, or even make a community. I don't really have any expectations for my art. I think, I don't know. I would be a little sad if I stopped making art all like entirely, but I have that natural feeling to do it still. So, and I feel like that won't go away. So I'm not super worried about that. Like art will still be something that I do. I'd like to make more money. that's something I would like in this next 5 years, but even then, it wouldn't be the end of the world. Traveling internationally would be really cool. I'll probably do it. Like now that I've done this car life thing, it's like I could probably do this anywhere. And also meeting a lot of people, they've given me a lot of resources that I can use to make like even international travel a lot more manageable. Like there's this stuff called, I think it's called Workshare, where you, do you know about it?
Yeah, I think I heard of it.
It's like you go to another country and like instead of paying for lodging, you pay in like working for their farm or whatever. So like you're more involved in the community, but it also helps you pay for your expenses. So like doing stuff like that makes international travel a lot more manageable. Like if you worked a job and then you had like a month or two off, or like even a few weeks, you could like fly to some country, be hosted by some farmer, work on their farm while you like experience like a whole another culture, which I think is like, and it would be an amazing vacation, you know? So yeah, they make stuff like that, and it's like the resources and the opportunities are out there. So I can see that happening too in the next 5 years. So yeah, the long answer is, or short answer is, I have no idea.
And I also want to mention Chloe Zhao's movie, Nomadland. I'm not sure if you got a chance to see
it. Oh, I've heard of it. I haven't seen it. I've heard of it. go ahead.
I'm not sure if you might like it or might not. Depends on if it realistically portrayed the life of, nomads like yourself, I think.
I met a guy who I think he either lives in a van or a car on the road, and then he watched it, and then he was just like, yeah, it was kind of boring because it was just like telling me stuff that I was already doing. but I think it'd be worth a watch, like why not.
Yeah, it's like another lifestyle, but I mean like yourself, it's new to the rest of us, but be something in reality for you. I guess as we're approaching the end of our interview, and I want to be cautious for your time, do you happen to have like a kind of a message to put in the time capsule for the future self?
Oh. Don't think too hard. Yeah, don't think too hard.
That's the message you would tell the future self. Mm-hmm. Whichever parallel universe, I guess.
There was, yeah.
Wow, that was amazing. Is there anything else you would like to add to this interview?
Not really. Just like, thanks for having me. Thanks for, showing interest in me. Like, I haven't even been seeing myself as much of an artist, but then you're reaching out to me like, hey, I've been like looking at your stuff and I like the stories, and like, even like read some of them. So it's like, that's very flattering to me. So thank you for that.
Well, thank you for your time and your presence and your work. I'm sure like many people out there will be finding them really healing at this time, especially. And the kind of coming out of the pandemic, but at the same time, yeah, there's a lot of things going on, and art is definitely most healing. And thank you for doing this.
Thank you for having me.